production of Imagine KC is made possible by the generous support of the Hall Family Foundation, the Healthcare Foundation of Greater Kansas City, the U.S. Department of Housing and Urban Development, the Garney Family Foundation Fund, Lafarge North America, the Urban Land Institute of Kansas City, and the Kansas City chapter of the American Institute of Architects. Imagine KC is a co-production of KCPT and the Mid-America Regional Council.
Hi, I'm Randy Mason.
And I'm Sue Patterson. Welcome back to Imagine KC, a series that looks at how our metro is striving to be more vibrant, connected, and green.
Over the last few months, we've shown you examples of the progress the region has made to become more sustainable. From reinvesting in historic downtowns to a new MAX line to understanding LEED building standards. We've looked at these stories through the lens of the three C's: centers, corridors, and conservation.
And in October of 2010, the region got a big boost for its planning efforts, an award of more than $4 million from the Department of Housing and Urban Development. And the Deputy Secretary of HUD paid KC a visit back in March to formally announce the grant.
What happens across the country normally on these issues is that we will are struck by the fact that regions don't talk to each other. So a city will say, give me the money, but don't give it to any of the suburbs. And suburbs will say, give it to us, but don't give it to the city. The rural areas will say, don't give it to anybody. We need the money. And in this particular case, everybody actually sat down and said, what are our mutual interests, and aren't we going to plan together? This was a highly competitive grant. 8 federal agencies and 14 foundations were at the table rating every single grant. The foundations from their perspectives, do the grants meet needs in regards to education? Do the grants meet health needs, transformation of neighborhoods? We can predict lifetime earnings by zip code. We can predict morbidity rates by zip codes. Is this plan going to deal with that? Who's at the table making the decisions? Is it just the few, or is it the many? Do we have community activists, faith-based community? Do we have the business community involvement as well as political involvement? And so this grant had all of them. So it was a strong grant, one of the largest that we gave because it was so strong.
Kansas City was just one of 45 areas awarded grants, and no doubt residents may be wondering what this means for the region. So joining us once again in the studio is David Warm, the executive director of the Mid-America Regional Council, who applied for the grant on behalf of more than 60 partners. So David, congratulations.
Thank you so much.
This is a really big deal for the region, but what we'd like to know is, what exactly does it mean?
Well, what it means is it's going to give us some resources to help pull the community together to help achieve a vision of sustainability. And by sustainability, I mean growth and development that can be sustained, growth and development that endures, that's affordable, that's resilient, that's adaptable. It means that we create different kinds of communities, and it's going to give us the resources to figure out ways to do that successfully. The nature in which we build our communities affects everything we do. It affects the quality of our daily life, it affects our economic opportunity, it affects our environmental health, and we're trying to grow in ways that allow us to achieve those objectives more fully in more places across the region.
And you're touching on transportation and public transit. That's a main component. What are some of the other components to the plan?
Well, when you think about a community, you think about it in pretty comprehensive terms. It's where do we live, where do we work, how do we get around, where do we play, where do we get our water, what's it look like? Mm-hmm. And so we're looking at how those things connect and express themselves in a different way across this metropolitan area than they have in recent decades.
And who are some of the key players and decision makers in the plan?
Well, we have more than 60 partners, and 30 or so of those are local governments, major local governments where your viewers live, and, mm-hmm. and their elected leaders and city officials are involved directly in this initiative. We have universities, we have community organizations, we have not-for-profit associations, really reflecting the gamut of interests that need to come together across this region to figure out how we can pull together to develop in more sustainable ways.
And as you are synthesizing all these local plans and pulling everything together, are there common themes that emerge? What are some of those from local plan to local plan? What are the things that stick out that may be common denominators?
Right. The plan that we are, the plan that we're pursuing that is focusing on specific corridors and activity centers around the region really began at the local community level. Comprehensive plans, local land use mm-hmm. plans that have been developed at the community level where these principles have been identified. And in all of these plans, there are some broad themes of trying to create places that are more vibrant, connected, and green. And if you unpack those terms, it means that we're trying to create places that, are walkable and compact and create a vibrant economy that's accessible to all communities, that we're able to move around and connect ourselves across this region in different ways, mm-hmm. and that we protect and preserve and develop in ways that respect the natural environment. And those themes are coming together in specific ways and will be implied in contexts that are very appropriate to each of the corridors that we're looking at.
This isn't in place to support capital or any projects to be executed. This is a foundational piece.
Correct. This is a planning initiative where we have some resources over a period of 3 years to pull the community together, to organize, to develop tools, and to apply them. But it's planning with a purpose, and it's planning with an objective. We are beginning with a plan that this community has already developed from the ground up, and we are using these resources to take it and move it toward implementation. It's not planning just to figure out where we want to go. It's to figure out how we can take our existing plans and put them into motion and to create momentum and to help individual local communities implement strategies that will be relevant to citizens and to businesses across our region. I think it was Dwight Eisenhower said that the process of planning is more important than the plan itself. It is the process of bringing people together to determine collectively how they want to move their own community forward. Mm-hmm. And so it is that commitment of bringing people together, developing a common vision, a common vocabulary, a common commitment to a direction that allows communities to progress in positive ways. We've done this forever in this country. We've done it in each of our communities. Our best communities are well-planned communities. We are now trying to look at that at a different scale, incorporating different principles of sustainability so we can work together to plan for a new, more sustainable metropolitan area.
Excellent. Thank you so much for joining us
again. It's my pleasure, as always.
And congratulations.
Thank you.
You can learn more about the Creating Sustainable Places initiative at our website, imaginekc.org. And we have lots more to talk about in just a few moments, but before we move on, let's revisit Lee Summit as an example of what communities are doing to be more sustainable.
New Longview is offering a mix of modern amenities with a folksy, familiar feel, building towards Lee Summit's future while holding on to a piece of its past.
What do you do with a 100-year-old water tank that's not needed anymore? Well, it's now a Sprint transmission tower. The entry arches that are approximately 50 feet wide and 35 feet tall, we picked those up, moved them off the roadway, and have rescued them. The elementary school was the rehabilitation of the 40,000-square-foot show horse arena. This is the gatehouse. This was a 100-year-old home. As anybody who has dealt with historic buildings, Union Station is exactly the same as Longview Farm. You only save these buildings with density. Density is a bad word. Apartments is a bad word. And we had to change the perspective, change the reality, and adjust their expectations of density. And density doesn't have to be bad. When you work with density, we understand that there has to be resting places, you know, little spots here where the mom and the baby can sit and rest and talk to the other moms and babies. This we refer to as our frog pond, and that's right there. So if the kids need to catch salamanders or frogs or just enjoy getting water in their boots, that's where they play. Where this becomes very, I'll say, comfortable is with the multitude of connections. If you come home from work or school, you have a multitude of choices to get to your home, not just the regular rat trap. Similarly, an evening walk or the kid on his bike riding to the neighbors. It's safer, it's slower. It makes for a more sociable index of that livable street, complete street connectivity.
You can go to our website, imaginekc.org, to watch the full segment. And you can also look at other features that highlight new urban planning principles in places like Zona Rosa and Park Place. It's one thing to look at the big picture planning of an initiative of this size, but there are a lot of factors that come into play, including the market. We have two folks with us who are charged with implementing and leading the Creating Sustainable Places initiative, Jan Marcason and Curt Skoog. Welcome, you all.
Thank you.
So, considering the diversity of the committee and all the different players that are involved, mm-hmm. and all the work that's done already on individual local city levels, how does the committee work to synthesize all that? And just how do you go about doing it? How does everyone work together?
What we're going to be doing over the course of the next 3 years is bringing in input from all of these diverse involved people in the task force building a toolkit for local communities to call on when they have a project. Over the course of the last few years in Overland Park, we've gone through the Vision Metcalf process, which encompasses, I think, a lot of the ideas that Creating Sustainable Places a steering committee wants to take a look at and include. Mm-hmm. There was a very large outreach to the community. And that's really, for a project to be successful, I really think that that's key.
Yeah.
So the Vision Metcalf project is starting to be implemented, and hopefully some of the learnings that we have will be applied to this project. And some of the learnings we're going to come together and plans can be reapplied back in Overland Park on the Vision Metcalf plan.
Excellent. And Jan, why don't you tell us some of the ways that Kansas City is making efforts to
Kansas City has challenges as well in making sure that a built community and an older community maintains a sustainable future. And so every project that comes to our city council, the people presenting that have to answer the question, how does this contribute to a sustainable Kansas City? So it's really done a lot to help educate our city staff in the importance of sustainability. And we went even farther recently. Every new building that the city is built has to have the gold LEED standard. And we worked very, very closely with, again, a wide range of stakeholders. We had to have the development community on board. We had to have the environmentalists on board. We had to have the neighborhood activists on board, the Home Builders Association. So we really, I think we can use some of what Kansas City learned in this process. And we have more to learn, but we want to be the greenest city in the United States.
And as co-chairs, you all have a big job yoking that all together. But it's an exciting one, too. Thanks for joining us so much. Again, you can learn more about Creating Sustainable Places Initiative at our website, imaginekc.org. As we mentioned, one aspect of sustainability is LEED building standards, a yardstick for sustainable construction. Here's a look back at a show place for these LEED features at the headquarters of J.E. Dunn in downtown Kansas City.
Businesses around this city are seeing that it makes sense. It really is good business. It's good business to show that they care about their employees, that they care about the environment. So a lot of companies are really adapting a sustainable approach.
Basically, throughout the building, we've got several signs that describe some of the sustainable features that we did on the building. And there's a description, and then we talked about what LEED-specific credits were achieved by doing this. So this one talks about this being an urban site. It was a redeveloped site. It used to be an asphalt parking lot. We've already got public transportation. All the utilities were already in place, so we didn't have to bring all that in. It was already here. So you save some money on that and get to reuse an existing plot of land. And so then here we've listed the three credits that we were able to achieve because of developing on an urban site. The intent is to try to keep as many materials sourced locally to reduce transportation costs, which therefore reduce emissions and greenhouse gas. So one of the LEED credits deals with trying to put materials in your building that are sourced from within 500 miles. I think you might have noticed the flooring. This is reclaimed. So this wood came from old barns in South Central Missouri. Then it was milled down and turned into flooring for us.
It truly is about the long run. It is about using less energy, having more environmentally friendly atmosphere for the workers, and to really take care of the environment that we live in.
You can see the entire segment, including some of the other locations I actually had the chance to see myself, the Sunset Building in Johnson County,
the Belle Prairie Elementary School in North Kansas City and the headquarters of Postie Cards, which is located just east of 18th and Vine. You can see all that at our website, imaginekc.org. But right now, I'm joined by three people who really believe in creating sustainable places to the extent that they are actually part of the steering committee that is moving forward with plans to really make this community more vibrant, connected, and green. On my left here, James Yorkie. He is the Sustainability Program Director for Johnson County. Margaret May is the Executive Director of the Ivanhoe Neighborhood Council. Welcome to Imagine KC. And a man many of us know from so many of the things he's contributed to the community, Bob Birkebeil, Principal at BNIM Architects. Glad to have you all with us. As we talk about LEED standards, for one thing, really illustrating a trend that I'm guessing 10 years ago, Bob, would have been hard to picture so many places right here in Kansas City starting to put them into play. Is that the case?
I think when LEED was started, it was a volunteer effort, and none of us imagined that it would have the growth and penetration that it's experienced. And so it's hard to know how that all happened, but one of the reasons was that the GSA, the federal realtor, decided to embrace it as their standard for buildings. And that changed America, really. And it was always intended to be a transformative tool to change the design and construction industry and to change the performance of our cities. And it's now reaching the traction that might be the case.
But so often we want things to change. It's hard to actually see them come into play. But James works for a county whose Sunset Building is, I said, just a fabulous non-governmental feeling entity that I would have imagined would have been a hard thing to get sold to the county to do. And yet it's happening and people visit it every day.
I think so. Initially, I think there was some concern that the Board of County Commissioners might not want to support a project like that. Ultimately, they did, and it's been a very successful thing because we've had over 10,000 people tour the building, and it's very energy efficient, and we estimate that we're saving hundreds of thousands of dollars a year across our energy efficient buildings to reduce our utility use. So it's a very successful project.
Is it seeing things on the ground, Margaret? Do you feel like Ivanhoe could be different and a more livable place because of these kinds of things?
Absolutely. We've worked very hard to begin that process over the past 10 years, and we were looking forward to this initiative actually carrying us at a much faster pace to making some very, very positive changes, not only in Ivanhoe and the surrounding Central City neighborhoods, but throughout our region.
We're not talking about LEED building standards necessarily as being the thing that's going to move your neighborhood. What literally will be different because of a initiative like this?
Well, first of all, just having an awareness of what's going on in Ivanhoe and neighborhoods like Ivanhoe by other communities within the region. And I contend that our wonderful area that we live in, this Kansas City region, that we all want to be vibrant and strong, will never ever be any stronger than the weakest point.
You were talking about some of the things off camera here that you feel like will make your neighborhood stronger. One of those was building more places for people to live in an area where that hasn't tended to be the case. As an architect, Bob, what kind of challenges face a neighborhood when they're trying to put, say, senior citizens into maybe an old movie theater or a school? Are those doable things?
They are, and they are being done elsewhere. And so that's the good news. Margaret and yes. We and the community have really good examples to look to inform how we do this. And I think to go back to the LEED system just for a moment as it relates to neighborhoods, we now have roughly 10,000 buildings in the LEED system nationally. And all those buildings are being tracked in terms of data. So we now have evidence that proves that if we design and build in this way at the building scale, we improve human health and productivity measurably. We know that test scores go up in schools 15% to 17%. We know that health records improve. And we know that operating costs diminishes. So when we start applying these same strategies to Margaret's neighborhood or to the metropolitan area, it increases quality of life, it reduces operating costs, and it increases the vitality of the system and the resiliency of the community long term. It's just extraordinary, but it requires a little bit of a shift. And as Margaret is looking at her neighborhood and looking at some of these empty buildings, it's back to your question, it's a little tough to make that first sale unless we agree as a community on a plan that this is where we're headed.
We're here to talk about sustainability, but one aspect of that is, it seems to be social equity. And it's we get lost sometimes in maybe some of the thoughts on green and the aspects of LEED, but what are we talking about needing to do?
We know from a lot of experience in other communities that when communities finally realized that the social part of this was an important part, often they adopted what's called triple bottom line performance, which basically means that every planning decision and every investment increases the vitality of the social, economic, and environmental system simultaneously. We have traditionally in America gotten into trade-offs. We say, we really need a return on this investment, so we're going to kind of forget the social side or the environmental side. And we've always thought it's one against the other. But the truth is, when you agree to this triple bottom line performance, communities are finding strategies that improve and enhance the vitality of all of them simultaneously. And I think that's what Margaret's talking about. And I think that the steering committee and Mark and the community are moving in the direction of figuring that out. And I'm really excited about it myself.
And that's one of the great things about how this committee has been formed. There's great diversity in every way represented on the committee. And from that, we'll get to the things that Bob has just mentioned, that sometimes are missing elements in our community as we're planning.
Triple bottom line.
Triple bottom line.
Yeah.
A going sentiment in circles? I've not even heard that term before.
It is. It's fundamental to understanding what sustainability is about. And that's something that in Johnson County, you know, when you talk about social equity, for example, transportation is a big piece of that, because right now we have sort of a fractured community which does not have good access to public transit for all people. And that limits people in terms of job opportunities and other quality of life issues. And so providing better transportation can foster a better quality of life for people all across the region. That's a big piece of what we're working on.
Well, there's 60 of you, as I understand, on this committee. So that's a lot of folks, a lot of opinions, and
you lots know, of fun.
With a great goal in mind, and obviously that is the exciting part of this creating sustainable places opportunity. Kansas City could be a really better place when all this is said and done. Will you accept any less?
We won't accept any less. It will be better. Isn't that right?
It is. And the 60 is indicative of the diversity in our community. And having that diversity represented in this steering committee, I think, is really appropriate, because we really need to explore all of the issues. The best visions, the biggest fears, all have to get resolved in order to get some clarity about where we're headed as a community.
Right. Well, I want to thank all of you for getting started on that discussion that I know you will be doing much, much more of as you work to create sustainable places. And as when we started our series, we were looking at plans for, among other things, the Troost Corridor. Well, we want to say that the new MAX line there is up and running, and we're going to wrap up this particular episode of Imagine KC by taking a look back at the features of this particular corridor improvement.
BRT, Bus Rapid Transit, as the name implies, is a service that's more rapid than the local bus. BRT is actually really more than simply that travel time improvement, though. It's really improving the entire transit experience for the customers. And you can see some of that here at 31st and Troost. It starts where you get on the bus. We have stations now rather than just bus stops. Stations that give you protection from the elements, a place to sit, a place to get good information about transit, good information about when the next bus is going to arrive, and real-time information. So it's a nice place to wait, nice place to get on the bus. The bus itself is a modern, low floor, very convenient bus to get on, has more knee to hip room, more room for your people seated in the bus, a little more comfortable ride. And in Troost in particular, we've widened some of the areas for people in wheelchairs.
What's your bus number, partner?
The tulip can be sort of a symbol of a solution, and it can bring people out of their homes, get people to meet each other, and they start having community, a real community. A real community is the nuts and bolts of the dirt on the ground and the litter on the ground. A tulip isn't going to solve it, but it's about unity. It's about something we can all do together, community.
Tulips on Truce. It's a wonderful project that's been going on for many years, and it's starting to move south, and so we're happy to be a part of it and literally plant the seeds for some beautification of Kansas City.
The tulip, historically, has been such a dynamic part of green and the earth. It's kind of the perfect emblem or symbol or whatever for something that is urban and decay, because it's the last thing you would think of doing.
So this is about beautification. It's about bringing people together to say, hey, some people do really care.
We're trying to transform this community. And that's what Tulips on Truce, I think, does for us, is that it is that very visible sign that there are things going on here, that we're trying to make this a better place to live and work.
You are capable of making your world beautiful. And you'll be amazed at what happens, because it's infectious. People want to be happy.
It is no small task imagining how to make this region a more sustainable one. And in the last few episodes, we've introduced a lot of great examples of the progress so far. Be sure to visit our website to watch past segments and learn about future plans at imaginekc.org.
And with spring finally in the air, you'll want to make sure you join us for our next edition of Imagine KC as we look at stories about community gardens, urban farming, and other efforts to create a healthy local food system to make the region more vibrant, connected, and green. Thanks for watching.
Production of Imagine KC is made possible by the generous support of the Hall Family Foundation, the Healthcare Foundation of Greater Kansas City, the U.S. Department of Housing and Urban Development, the Garney Family Foundation Fund, Lafarge North America, the Urban Land Institute of Kansas City, and the Kansas City chapter of the American Institute of Architects. Imagine KC is a co-production of KCPT and the Mid-America Regional Council.